want to live free or do you want to die being bound? Exodus chapter 3. Let's look at verse number 7. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. Who are the taskmasters? The Egyptians, right? Okay. Because of their taskmasters. For I know their sorrow. I've heard their cry because the Egyptians were beating them up, punishing them for them to work hard. So I have come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, to bring them up from the land of that land to a good land, a large land, to a land flowing with milk and honey, and to the place of the Canaanites and the Hittites and the Amorites and the Perizzites and the Hivites and the Jebusites, all the ites, we get rid of. Now therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come up to me, and I have also seen the oppression which the Egyptians oppressed them. Now, Israel is crying to God, and God Bible says, what are they crying for? Okay, they want to be free, perfect. Okay. Come now, therefore, verse 10, and I will send you to Pharaoh, that you may bring my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I? That I should go to Pharaoh, and that I should bring the children of Israel out of Egypt. God, I'm not qualified for this stuff. How are you calling me to preach and tell a pastor to prophesy about me? Me? Father, I'm not qualified, as we said to God. I can't do this, God. I'm not qualified for this kind of stuff. Okay. God said, I will certainly be with you. Now, that right there should have the church. It's over right there. God said, I will certainly be with you. Yes. Now ask me, but what else do you want? Now this is God. He didn't say, I will be with you. He said, because he knows language. He said, I will certainly. So when you are uncertain, I have said, I am certainly with you. Yes. I am there with you, Moses. You don't have to be afraid. I'm certainly with you. And this shall be a sign to you that I sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall serve God on this mountain. Now Moses isn't satisfied because certainly being with him is not enough. So now Moses takes it up a notch. And Moses said to God, indeed, when I come to the children of Israel and say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you, and they say to me, what is his name? What shall I say? Because after 400 years, many of them didn't even know God anymore. And Moses, God said to Moses, tell them what? I am who I am. Or King James Version said, I am that I am. I am the great I am. I am the one who delivered you. All right, let's go to Exodus chapter 14. So we bear it in mind that God said, I will certainly, don't forget that, I will certainly be with you. The moment a believer or a person, a sinner, decides to accept Christ, this promise is attached to their life.
Yes, amen.
I will certainly be, I said, the moment you make a decision to accept the Lord, this guarantee and this promise has been made.
Amen.
Now you can begin to reflect on all the troubles you face since you're serving God. And the promise is still applies. That's why he's still here.
Amen.
So Exodus 14 now. And those of you who know me by now, I love the word. So I read a lot of it. Now the Lord spoke to Moses, verse 1. Ready?
Yeah.
Saying, speak to the children of Israel, that they turn and come before Pi-Hahiroth, between Migdol and the sea. Now keep this in mind, opposite Baal Zephon. God is telling them a specific location for them to be, right?
Yes.
Now, if you have a highlighter or a pen, or whatever you have, highlight verse 2. Who told them to settle by Pi-Hahiroth? God said, go to this specific location and let it come.
Yes.
Okay. Now, to the church, though, the moment you hear God, God says, I'm delivering you out of trouble. Because now we told Israel, I heard you cry. I've seen all the stuff you go through. I'm about to deliver you. Go and set a camp up by Pine Valley Road. The average church goer says, wow, no more trouble. God is taking me out of trouble into a place of absolute peace. Because that's our concept of deliverance. Our concept of deliverance is the absence of warfare. So are you quiet? A believer in the church who wants freedom doesn't really want freedom. Let me get you upset for a second. Half of you here who say they want freedom, they don't want freedom. They want to they desire the termination of trouble. They don't want freedom. They just want a life that is free of issues.
Yes, true.
You don't want freedom from where? Because freedom has a price tag that church people don't have to pay. Listen. When the Israelites were in bondage in Egypt, they could point their finger and say, they have me in trouble. That's easy. When you're in bondage, you can easily say when your relatives come to see you in jail, you see them, they lock me up. The judge did wrong. The lawyer was a bum. And that's why I'm in the cell. You have excuses to make. But the day the judge signed your release paper form and said, you're free to go, who you point your finger at and do foolishness again. Freedom brings you face to face with your internal self.
Yes.
And many people could have been in prison without dealing with their internal self. Because there's no one to blame when you're free. But the church people want freedom, meaning God, pay my bills. I must not get sick. My family must be absolutely perfect. No attack from the enemy. Give me a life of ease, and that's called freedom. God told them, go to this place, Pi Hahiroth, between Migdal and the sea. And opposite Baal Zephon, you shall camp before it by the sea. Now say set up. God is a strategist, boy. That's why I don't fight him. But the journey could set you up, I mean, now you're feeling good because God is saying, you're free. It sounds good. I don't have to make bricks anymore. I don't have to be beaten in the sun anymore. They're not giving me leaves and garlic to eat anymore. I'm going to a land from which milk and honey. That sounds good, doesn't it? And then God said, now go by the sea. Alright? So I'll obey you because I'm not having to make bricks. And if you're lazy, you run the first day, you don't obey Israel. Egypt. Because you don't want to make the brick. So you say, drop the tools, let's go on the journey. We're free. But what would God say? Verse 3, for Pharaoh will say of the children of Israel, they are bewildered and they travel by the land. The wilderness has clothed them in. I can handle verse 3, but verse 4 is my problem. Then, read it. I said, read it for the people on the internet to hear, you know, they're listening to by the way of the internet. Talk to them. Then I will do what? Who is hardening his heart? Now, I read this over so fast many years ago in my life, David, that I missed something right here. God is telling me, you're free. And the next thing he tells me is, I will harden the heart of the person who kept me in prison. Now, hold on a minute here. Why are you delivering me, God?
True.
Or why are you softening his heart to let me go? And then harden his heart to come after me? How can it be God? How can it be God who is telling Pharaoh, go after the same people as me? I can hear you believers in the church. God will not go in like that. That's not the kind of God I serve. God is not confused. God knows what he wants. If he says something about me, it shall happen. Yes! It will happen. After. It would happen before.
Yes.
God said, I will be hardening his heart. So that he will pursue them. Oh my God. Woo. Now this this is God talking to one man who's healing over 2 million people out of captivity. He didn't tell Israel to stay there because they would leave. He told one person. So Moses is going to lead the people with the information that Pharaoh is coming after them. He said, I will do this so I will have honor over Pharaoh. And that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord. The Egyptians are going to know. Your enemies are going to be assured after this that he is God. Now all the stuff they come to do to you, do not say that it is not God. Because if God doesn't want the enemy to attack you, he wouldn't let him attack you. The reason why the enemy is attacking you is because God has sent him to you. Now you might as well make up your mind that you're prepared to go through the trial and come out victorious, or you could complain and see the enemy every day of your life.
Hallelujah.
Because believers believe for an easy way out. They don't believe to see the power of God or the manifestation of God or the kingdom of God. They believe for the easy way out. But I apologize to you for the pastor who told you that it was going to be easy when you got saved. I'm sorry.
Amen. Amen.
Because it doesn't go that way. So God says to them, the Egyptians will have information. I believe in declarations. I'm not the kind of preacher to tell you say things versus saying it. It must come out of your mouth because words are spirit and life. God says the Egyptians will know. Now you make a declaration, say my enemies.
My enemies.
I didn't say whisper, it's in the secret.
My enemies.
My enemies.
They have information.
They have information.
That's what I want to give you right there. Because some of your enemies treat you this way because they don't have information. But next year, God give me the word I ran for it. Next year is the year of manifestation for this church.
Yes.
Next year is the year of manifestation.
Yes.
All the enemies and jokers around who thought you were just average and nobody. Next year.
Yes.
Next year, your trials of 2013 will make sense.
Yes.
Oh, that's good. Yes. If you endure this year, the next few weeks of this year, without changing your confession that God I'm gonna put